The Practice of Belonging. 6 lessons from vibrant communities to combat loneliness, foster diversity, and cultivate caring relationships. By Lisa Kentgen, PhD. Narrated by Lisa Kentgen. Published by North Atlantic Books. Introduction: A Crisis in Belonging. Melissa could never have imagined her successful life, having a meaningful full-time job with good benefits and people who love and respect her. She values giving back, especially when she can inspire others to believe that change is possible for everyone at any time. Melissa also has the relatively new experience of feeling pride in her accomplishments. Yet she knows she wouldn't be here without the support and care of others. Today, Melissa places a high value on being intentional in all her relationships, mindful of how her words, choices, and actions impact others. She admires people within her communities who have been intentional in their interactions with her, a quality that built trust between them. She works at a probate court, where she interfaces with hundreds of people daily by phone and in person. When people are coming to probate court, 90% of the time there is a sad story behind it, she said. She performs her job with compassion and has a perspective that is a little different from her coworkers. Growing up, Melissa learned important life lessons from her mother, such as acceptance, non-judgment, and caring for others. But she didn't have access to people who could model how to succeed in life in terms of supporting herself and her family. Finding that would wait until she discovered community while she was incarcerated. Two of Melissa's favorite things to talk about are the Harmony Project and the Tapestry Program, the two communities responsible for helping her turn her life around. She encountered both as an inmate in the Ohio Reformatory for Women in Marysville, Ohio, just outside Columbus. The first 18 months of her 3-year sentence were spent in the Tapestry Program, a unique therapeutic community of 80 women within the larger prison. There, Melissa received intensive behavior therapy for her recovery, as well as other educational opportunities. She was surrounded by her sisters, other women in the program, who were a powerful source of support and acceptance. This community helped her through the darkest times, when guilt and remorse just about killed her, by letting her know she was not alone. Women in the Tapestry Program have the opportunity to participate in the Inside Out Choir, part of the Harmony Project in Columbus. According to Melissa, when the Harmony volunteers enter the facility for weekly choir practice, they usher in a big wave of energy and love. Quote, David Brown, the choir director, brings 25 other people, and you can tell by their body language, how they look at and talk to you, that they genuinely care. End quote. After she graduated from the Tapestry Program, she returned weekly as an alumna to participate in the choir, also serving as a model for other women there. As her release date neared, Melissa knew it was not in her best interest to leave the halfway house where she was living and return to Newark, Ohio, where she lived at the time of her arrest. They like to send you back to your county where you were charged, which is not supportive, she explained. She went to her unit manager and said, I can't go back to Newark. The people I met are all in Columbus. I want to go there and be part of the Harmony Project program. She recalls a pivotal moment from that time. I can remember a conversation I had with David a few months before my release about my wanting to come to Columbus. He assured me, you come to Columbus, Melissa. You don't have to worry. We will make sure that you are good. Ronnie Burks Trousdell, another choir member, supported Melissa's decision to land in Columbus. This carried weight because Ronnie was the warden of the Ohio Reformatory for Women and the person who had partnered with David to bring Harmony into the prison. The first phone call Melissa made when she was free was to Harmony. After being released with no money or street clothes, 8 days later, she attended choir practice. Melissa remembers her fear when she arrived at that first choir practice as a free woman. "I got there super early and immediately felt the love. David and Shelby, the office manager, took me into the office instead of making me go to the choir space by myself, and we began building connections just then. And when it was time to go to choir practice, Shelby locked arms with mine and said, 'Come on, Melissa.' They walked into the choir space, and Melissa was enveloped in tears, hugs, and love. They weren't just any kind of hug, but the kind she wasn't allowed to have in prison, a 30-second healing hug, where you feel someone else's heart beating next to yours." Melissa says Tapestry is different from the rest of the correctional facility and that hugs are allowed, but they must be brief. Melissa read me a beautiful poem she had written and read during a Harmony concert in the Ohio Theater to an audience of over 5,000 people. The poem included these words: "I'm stuck daily, daydreaming and wondering if I'll ever be the me I deserve to be. Now I'm here and it's changing, sober, determined, loved, amazing. I'm still so shocked by the changes going on inside of me. Living healthy is like being in a dream." The Harmony Project, through music and volunteer service, meaningfully connects people who otherwise wouldn't cross paths. In 2009, Harmony began as a single choir of 100 people, none of whom were required to audition. Since then, thousands of people have participated in its choirs, programs, and service projects, and many thousands of people have sat in the audience of its biannual concerts. You'll read more about this choir in Chapter 1. David, the choir's director, laments all the ways in which we are separated from each other. "What I believe we're doing here in Harmony is finding new ways to live together," he says. "We're focusing on what connects us beyond the fact that we're going to vote differently, pray differently, and live and love differently." Belonging is an essential human need. This book is about belonging, which is a central issue of our time. It is a call to stretch our conception of connection and to strengthen the we muscle that has atrophied. Our collective health and the sustainability of the planet require a shift of focus toward relating to each other in fundamentally different ways. The experience of belonging is essential for physical health, emotional well-being, and the ability to do well in life. A meta-analysis that looked at nearly 150 smaller studies with over 300,000 participants within the studies found that a sense of belonging had a positive health impact as powerful as quitting smoking, diet, and exercise combined. Whatever a person's age or particular life circumstances, they will live healthier and longer if they have a sense of belonging. When children experience belonging in school, they are better able to proactively shape their lives later on. The number one influence on how teenagers perform in high school is whether they feel they fit in. What kids take away from their entire school experience and how it prepares them for adulthood has more to do with whether they find a social home than all the effort that goes into educating them. If we take this seriously, then every educational system's priority should be creating an atmosphere of safety and belonging. The importance of belonging is not fully appreciated, and we are currently in a crisis of connection that has catastrophic consequences. Though this crisis is not new, we are witnessing its effects more clearly than ever before. A 2018 survey of 20,000 adults found that nearly half of those who responded felt lonely and did not have meaningful social interactions on most days. This crisis of belonging is reflected in high rates of depression among people of all ages, with the highest increases seen in young people and the elderly. This crisis is sometimes referred to as a loneliness epidemic. Loneliness is a state of mind in which people feel alone, empty, and unwanted. Even when other people are around, loneliness leaves us experiencing ourselves as disconnected and separate. Loneliness is linked with poor mental and physical health, and like depression, it is growing.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.